Hello and welcome back to History Tweaks for another alternate history scenario. 1657 CE, Mughal India. Shah Jahan is on the peacock throne of Delhi, the capital of the empire. Among his sons, Dara Shikoh is with the emperor, while Murad Bakhsh is the viceroy in Gujarat. Aurangzeb is posted in Deccan and Shah Shuja is in Bengal. September of 1657. The emperor falls seriously ill and hence he names his eldest son Dara as his successor. The other brothers of Dara had a contempt towards him, and even Shah Jahan had at times said to have hinted that he wanted to leave the empire to his multi-talented son Shuja. Shuja was made the governor of Bengal, Orissa and Assam mainly due to his excellent administrative capabilities and his flair of decisiveness. He was also good at learning languages and was sensitive to customs and cultures of other regions. By 1657, however, his initial flair was lost. His grand administrative achievements and extraordinary trade deals meant that Bengal became prosperous and stable, and lack of existential threats meant that Shah Shuja became complacent in taking decisions, and similar waning of capabilities was also seen on part of the Bengal army stationed in the Suba. But nonetheless, Shah Shuja could be counted as the most capable among his brothers, at least a far cry from Aurangzeb. And Bengal too remained the most prosperous region even though its army's capabilities waned. September 6, 1657, a rumor spread throughout India that Shahanshah Jahan was dead and Dara was using the emperor's seal to consolidate himself. The three other Shahzadas marched towards Delhi to claim the throne. From west marched Murad and Aurangzeb, who had signed a pact, and from the east marched Shuja, who due to being far had no such pact but was in good relations with his brother Aurangzeb. Dara commanded the imperial army to counter Murad and Aurangzeb and sent his son Suleiman to fight Shuja. The Bengal army was ill-trained and indisciplined, so Suleiman could encircle their camp at night, and Shuja was defeated and returned to Bengal with a truce, gaining the Suba of Bihar as the Subedar and pledging allegiance to Dara. On the other hand, Murad and Aurangzeb had defeated Dara, who fled to Sindh. Upon entering Delhi, Aurangzeb captured his father and betrayed his brother Murad and imprisoned him, where he was poisoned under suspicious circumstances. Then he chased down Dara but maintained friendly relations with Shuja. After defeating Dara, Aurangzeb executed him. Learning of the evils of Aurangzeb, Shuja, who was very fond of his father, amassed another army and marched towards Delhi. As Aurangzeb crowned himself Shahanshah e Hind, their forces met at the town of Khajwa in Fatehpur. Initially, Shuja utilized his elephants and looked to be gaining the upper hand, but through a series of near misses and indecisiveness, Shuja lost the battle and had to flee the battleground, with the commander of the Mughal army, Mir Zumla, chasing him. Shuja hid his immense personal wealth with the trusted zamindars of Bengal and took a part of it with him to Arakan, where he stayed until he was killed, betrayed by the local king to Aurangzeb. This then led to Aurangzeb's 50-year rule, which saw the Mughal empire reach its maximum extent, but his extremist view and headstrong administrative policy and unpopular taxes caused many rebellions and instability in the empire, and soon the empire broke apart after his death, providing excellent opportunity for the British to conquer India. But what if all that changed? What if Shah Shuja defeated Aurangzeb at the Battle of Khajwa? Now, for this to happen, we need to change a couple of things during Shah Shuja's time as Viceroy to make sure the spark of Shuja and the Bengal army is not lost. Shah Shuja showed the pinnacle of his decisiveness and capability in the conquest of Odisha and subduing of the Zamindar of Hijli in 1651. In this timeline, in 1653, Shah Jahan announces an invasion of Ahom. Shuja is put in charge of the campaign and Shah Jahan remains in Delhi. The first attacks are repelled, causing another humiliation of the Mughals against the Ahom. But this humiliation is taken very seriously by Shuja, and he reforms the cavalry charge techniques and expands the war elephant corps in the army. He also instills higher discipline in the army. By 1654, the counterattack succeeds, and by 1655, the kingdom of Ahom falls, and Coch Bihar, who is an ally to Ahom, is soon to follow. The assimilation and administrative restructuring of the region kept the systems, the army, and most of all, capabilities of Shah Shuja at their peak. The treasury of Bengal also grows as a result of this conquest, with funds coming from the trade of the local Muga and Tosher silks, which are more durable than the ones from China, and which is cultivated and woven in the regions of Ahom and Kuch Bihar. Shah Shuja, with help from Dutch and the British, introduces European weapons in the army, especially in the Bengal regiments, along with flotille to navigate the rivers of the Gangetic Plains. Along with this, with the permission from the Badshah, just as in our timeline, he starts the Mughal Merchant Navy fleet and highly aids the sea trade. All these reforms were brought by Shah Shuja even in our timeline, but the major change here is he instills higher discipline in his troops. September 6, 1657, the rumor of Shah Jahan's death breaks and Shuja sets off with the army to Delhi. He meets the forces of his nephew Suleiman near Banaras, and in this timeline the forces are more prepared, but they are still very ill trained due to the hasted recruitments, and hence Shuja is defeated and then signs a pact with Suleiman, just as in our timeline. But by 1658, Aurangzeb imprisons Shah Jahan and backstabs Murad. Soon he also executes Dara and his son Suleiman. Aurangzeb sends a letter stating that he will respect Shuja's claim on Bihar as Subedar, but Shuja is privately horrified by the imprisonment of Shah Jahan, who is very fond of, and the death of Murad and Dara. Dara, though he didn't like very much, he never wanted to kill him, and he was very fond of Suleiman, his nephew. Hence, he starts amassing an army again. He trains them and instills discipline into them. He also increases the cavalry corps and makes an armored gunner's division. The army is marched to Delhi and meet the imperial army of Aurangzeb at Khajwa. He first charges with the cannon and the war elephants, which heavily impact the imperial cavalry and kills its commander. The troops frenzy and fight into the artillery charge. The main war elephants also decimate the reserve cavalry. The attacks by the flotille from the river also damage the imperial cannons. Mir Zumla is killed and Aurangzeb is forced to retreat, and Fatehpur is captured by Shuja. After capturing Fatehpur, Shuja releases a farman, making known the treachery of Aurangzeb. The Mansabdars of Gujarat, learning of treachery against their Subedar Murad, rally behind Shuja, and so do the Mansabdars of Punjab, loyal to Dara, who are led by his second son Sipe. Shuja also declares that once at Agra, he will set Shah Jahan free and step aside and serve the emperor as his courtier. With support, fresh reinforcements, and moral high ground attained, Shuja marches towards Agra. Aurangzeb meets the army off the river Yamuna, and as the battle starts, gunfire from the gunner's corps and the flotille stuns the troops. As the war elephants charge, half the Aurangzeb's troops desert him. The remaining forces engage with Shuja's army, but soon retreat back to Delhi. Shuja enters the Agra fort and sets his father free and reinstates him as the emperor, and he himself relinquishes the title. His flotille head to Delhi via the river Yamuna, and his army takes the land route. By 1560 CE, the Delhi army surrenders, and Aurangzeb is forced to step down and is imprisoned. Shuja with Shah Jahan comes to Delhi, and Shah Jahan ascends the peacock throne. Shuja is appointed at the court. Shah Jahan wants to keep Aurangzeb imprisoned, but influenced by Shuja, he is appointed the Subedar of Kashmir under the supervision of their sister Jahanara. Shah Shuja's son Zainuddin Mirza is appointed the Subedar of Bengal, while Aurangzeb's son is given Deccan. Dara's second son is the Subedar of Punjab, and Murad's son is appointed in Gujarat. In 1562 CE, the ailing Shah Jahan passes away, and Shah Shuja ascends the peacock throne as Shahenshah-e-Hind. Aurangzeb accepts his rule unconditionally and is given the region of Kabul to administer. The first act of Shuja is to consolidate the empire. Shuja greatly admired his great-grandfather Akbar and was known to administer in a similar fashion by division of administrative responsibilities. After coming to power, he improves the Todarmal Bandobast and applies it to the newly conquered regions for greater revenue. He launches army expedition into the Kalinga region to bring the hinterlands under imperial control. By 1564, the region is brought firmly under Mughal control. Shuja uses Akbar's strategy of converting the local kings into subedars and let them administer their own regions in return for taxes and regular military service. Shuja also restarts Akbar's practice of creating divisions with people from many races and religions. During the Wars of Succession, the Bahmani Sultanate had declared themselves independent and Oven conquered. Marathas had also risen. Shuja, being the shrewd diplomat, first negotiates with the Marathas to go to war against Bahmani and then subdues the Golconda Sultanate, or what we now know as the Hyderabad region. In 1668 CE, the Mughals launch a campaign to capture Bahmani. By 1670, the Bahmani and Golconda Sultans are duly appeased. Then, Shah Shuja launches a campaign to capture Kandahar, which had been lost against the Safavid Empire of Persia, and the fortress is won back. He also expands the Mughal merchant fleet and starts building the Mughal navy. The Mughal Empire would grow rapidly in terms of territory and economy. The Marathas, on the other hand, would not be able to grow as rapidly because the secular policies of Shuja would mean lower discontent and hence lesser support for the Marathas, because people always prefer the most comfortable option, which in this case would be the status quo. Shah Shuja's reign would mark the high point in trade revenue of the empire. Extensive trade would be carried out through merchant fleets with China and the East, and the British and Dutch companies would also contribute to the trade. Shah Shuja would soon learn the Dutch language and start innovations in the army and the navy using their technology. The jewel of the empire would be Bengal, Shah Shuja's earliest Subha. Shuja would initiate extensive construction projects in Dhaka, Murshidabad and Rajmahal. He would also construct ports in Dhaka and Chittagong and would commission one in Gujarat modeled on the port of Amsterdam. During the excavation, remains of the Lothal port would be found. Shuja would call Dutch archaeologists to examine the area. Dutch and Indian historians would start finding clues to the existence of the Indus Valley civilization. In 1875 CE, expeditions are launched against the Madurai Nayaks, and for the first time, the Mughal forces fight at land as well as at sea. By 1677, the Nayaks surrender and their dominions are brought under the control of the Mughals. 1678 CE, the Mughal Empire sent an envoy to Europe under the Emperor's son Zainuddin Mirza to make ties with the Netherlands. The envoy meets the Emperor of the Netherlands as well as the British Isles, William of Orange, in the Dutch court at Hague. In 1679, the Dutch respond by sending their own envoy to the Mughals. A permanent Dutch embassy is also established at Delhi and a Mughal consulate in Holland. Shah Shuja invites famous painters from Holland and England to paint the life in his empire. With William of Orange becoming the King of Britain, British influence is also increased in the empire. In 1682 CE, an expedition to the south is launched and the regions of Mysore, Malabar, Kochi and Anakal are brought under the empire, and so is the empire of Kandy in Sri Lanka. By this time, due to the unpopular rule of Sambhaji, the Maratha Empire would be on the verge of collapse. Shuja would offer protection and marital alliances in return for accepting him as their ruler. Sambhaji would refuse, but with his death, the empire would start breaking up and his son Shahu would agree to the terms. In 1690 CE, Shuja invites the famous English architects St. Christopher Vaughan and William Kent to design a building to serve as the summer royal pleasure hall in Delhi. This would introduce the English Palladian style in India, and owing to the similarities between the Indian architecture and the Palladian architecture, the two would merge to form the Indo-Palladian styles of architecture. In 1700 CE, Shah Shuja would issue a farman making his son Zainuddin Mirza, a much-loved prince, his successor. He would also launch an expedition into Manipur and the Arakan lands to expand trade and for their valuability as trading outposts. By 1701, the Manipur, Mizoram and Nagaland regions would be captured, and later the Arakan region would also be captured. By 1702, the Mughal armies would push southward to capture the Yangon Delta and also project their influence into the kingdoms of Myanmar. In 1701, another Palladian palace would also be commissioned for Shah Shuja's loving sister Roshanara Begum in Lucknow. In 1703, at the age of 86,
Shah Shuja passes away and his son succeeds him to the throne. He is given the title Alam by his uncle Aurangzeb, who subsequently passes away in 1707. Under Emperor Alam I, the empire is further restructured and the navy is strengthened. In 1708, Alam establishes British embassy in Delhi and calls British geologists to examine coal deposits in his realm. The British also introduce tea plantations in Assam and gain rights for trade for the crop. Tea is soon introduced into the court as a beverage. Alam calls British historians to work alongside with the Hindustani historians to continue findings and documentation of the Indus civilization. Being very good at languages like his father, he soon learns English and commissions a translation of the Bible into Arabic, Urdu, Hindi, and Bengali. A new language also develops under his reign and gains popularity in the regions of Delhi, and the language is known as Urdu. Alam's reign sees a golden age in art and technology and further propagation of the Indo-Palladian style of architecture, which quickly gained traction due to its similar features with the Mughal style. 1715 CE, Alam launches an expedition westwards to conquer back the regions beyond Kandahar from the failing Safavid Empire. By 1755 CE, the regions of Afghanistan, Balochistan and parts of Sistan are conquered from the broken Safavid Empire. In 1720 CE, Alam opens the first iron and steel plant in India in Bihar. This is followed by a rifle factory and a cannon foundry. Soon, multiple other factories are opened by various subedars and zamindars. And hence, by 1745, there are at least a dozen factories in India. 1745 CE, Emperor Alam passes away and his son Akbar II takes the throne. During Akbar II's reign, English influence in the court is increased. Akbar II also sends aid to England during the Seven Years' War against France. France tries to incite rebellion, but it is subdued with the help of the British. During his reign, the Burmese kingdom are also fully integrated into the empire systems. Akbar II dies in 1780 CE and is the last of the great Mughals. His successors become more and more complacent in ruling and the empire becomes unstable. Seeing their sources of income collapse and their political ambitions gaining traction, the British offer help to the ruling emperors. And soon the emperors start yielding more and more power to the ministerial council containing of the British and their Indian allies. They soon start introducing exploitative policies towards Indians and start styling themselves the great advisory ministry of the emperor, or Shehenshah ki Azim Mushawarti Wazarat. Soon, some subedars and officials of the army grow discontent with the rule of the Europeans, and with the accession of an Anglo-skeptic Mughal, we could see a Sepoy revolt-style rebellion around the 1850s. But this would inevitably fail. But the long rule of Mughals would mean that people would associate themselves to India and have a political identity. Hence, mass movements will rise following the rebellion. After the rebellion, the British replace the emperor and start a new dynasty of puppet emperors. The deposed emperor would be sent into exile into the Ottoman Empire. We would see the title of Malika-e-Hind being given to the Queen Victoria, while the Mughals act as viceroy of her government. A new ministry is founded within the British government, known as the Ministry of Colonial India, and the minister is made Wazir of India. This would start the Angrezi Hukumat, which would be very similar to the British Raj in our timeline, but it would be more subdued and the government would intervene through the Shehenshah. During the Angrezi Hukumat, the areas of Gorkha kings of Nepal would be brought under the empire, and by 1860 we could see the conquest complete, including Bhutan. Just as in our timeline, the British Raj would see the establishment of railways in the Indian subcontinent. But in this timeline, the railways would be state-run and the first railway would be established at the request of the emperor. In 1865 CE, at the behest of the emperor, the first railway in India would be planned from Delhi to Agra, going through Bulandshahr and Aligarh. The route would be planned to leave Delhi, go southwards to Faridabad, then turn westwards to Bulandshahr, then proceeding southwards to reach Aligarh, from where it veered southwest to reach Mathura, from where it turned back east to reach Agra. In 1868 CE, the first train of the Indian subcontinent would run from Delhi to Agra, carrying the members of the royal family
the emperor and the members of the ministerial council. Impressed by the new technology and obviously coerced by the ministerial council, the emperor would commission new state-funded routes from Delhi to Kolkata and Delhi to Chittagong via Agra, and also from Delhi to the Mughal port at Ahmedabad, Bombay, and reaching the port at Ratnagiri, from where Hajj would be carried out. The railways would be further expanded to connect Delhi to Kabul and Kandahar. The railways would be further expanded to connect Delhi to Mysore and Kochi, and to Hyderabad via the East Coast Railway, and to connect the ports of Karachi and Balochistan to Delhi. Railways would also be laid in Myanmar, reaching Rangoon. Construction of a bridge connecting India and Sri Lanka over the Pak Strait would also be started by the British. On the political side of things, the independence movement would be gaining a lot of ground, especially after the Sepoy Revolt in the 1850s. We could see the movement become popular, and in the 1890s, we could see the foundation of a party similar to the Indian National Congress. And for simplicity, I would call it the Indian National Congress even in this timeline. And the ideas of mass struggle would also gain traction. See, the idea was not the monopoly of Gandhiji. He did take it to a higher level, but it was already present in the Indian National Congress and was propagated by leaders like Gopal Krishna Gokhale and Lala Lajpat Rai. Because the plus point of mass struggle and non-violence is that it can engage the masses and does not require separating yourself from family and society. And hence, in this timeline, mass struggle would be popularized by some leader like Gandhiji. Or one could just assume that Gandhiji is still born despite the butterfly effect in the timeline. In 1914, the World War II would break out and civil disobedience movement would rage on in India. The demands of restoring the rightful Mughal and replacement of a ministry by an Indian self-government would be put forth. The Ottomans would use this to cripple the British in India. Even China, where Europeans would have similar influence, would start seeing its own rebellion inspired by India. But the Chinese rebellion may be armed, just as in our timeline. The Indian revolts would cripple the British, but that wouldn't mean that Germany would win. We could still see the US intervene and the Allies' power win the war. But with the war drawing to a close and the devastation in the British Isles, the crippled Britain would prepare to hand over power to the Indians. The rightful Mughal would be restored as the Viceroy, and the transfer of government control would take place by 1920. The advisory ministry would be abolished and a parliament would be established. And finally, the title of Shahenshah e Hind would be returned to the Mughal Emperor by 1930. This would end the Angrezi Hukumat and revert India back into the hands of the Mughaliya Sultanate, centered at Delhi. Following the 1930 independence, the systems would be restructured and the Constituent Assembly formed, which would be housed in the famous Sabarmati Palace of the Mughals in Delhi, which would then subsequently house the Parliament of the nation as well. By this time, we could also see the granting of self-rule to China, establishment of a republican government. On the other hand, in Russia, the USSR would be formed and consolidated by 1930, and it would also share a land border with the Sultanate, owing to the Sultanate's holding in Afghanistan. The Subas would be restructured based on languages, and for the first time, elections would occur in Indian subcontinent for the posts of the Subedar and his legislative assemblies. By 1938, the Constitution of Hindustan would be adopted, and the Shahenshah's title would be changed to Shahenshah-e-Hindustani Awam, or the Emperor of the Indian People. His powers would be limited, being similar to that of Queen Victoria. And the constitutional monarchy of Hindustan would be established, with the parliament at the Summer Palace of the Mughals on the banks of the river Yamuna in Delhi. The constitutional monarchy of Hindustan would be acclaimed internationally as just Hindustan, and would have good relations with USSR and may have good relations with China as well if they retain their republican nature. But now you may ask, all this is well and good, but this looks too much like the India in our timeline. So how would it be different? Well, the biggest difference would be that the general attire of Indians would stop looking like this and look more something like this. Because the civil services would still be handled by Indians and in the name of the emperor. An English attire would not be a compulsion in civil services or in schools, and hence the attire would be less Western and more Indian as a whole. The English language as well would have less influence in India, and the regional languages as well as Hindi and Urdu would be given a higher status. Overall, India would be a bit more prosperous than in our timeline and much more Indian. And that is where I'll end this scenario for now. Hope everyone enjoyed it. Thank you and have a good day. Don't forget to like the video to support the growing empire and subscribe to join its administrative ranks. Thank you again.